I hope when you are watching this video, my teaching schedule for next year will be finalized. Anyway, check out my website taichiaking.com for my upcoming workshops. Someone comments on my Daoist Neigong introduction video, inquiring about the connection between Lao Zi, the author of Dao De Jing, and the Daoist religion. I replied that it is not a straightforward answer. And when I find the time, I'll create another video to explain the details. It's taken me a while, but here you go. I want to emphasize that some of the information I'm sharing in this video is derived from my master's knowledge, which may differ from the official version. So don't regard this as an academy source. Rather, consider it as more of a storytelling. Let's begin by tracing the origins of Daoism. Like many authentic spiritual traditions, Daoism finds its roots in the Himalaya region. I've been fortunate to visit this special place 3 times and have had some interesting encounters. To the south lies India, while Tibet is to the north, the Middle East to the west, and China to the east. By the way, have you ever wondered why yoga tradition talk about 7 chakras? Tibetan practices primarily focus on 5 chakras, and Daoists only work with 3 dantins. If you have insight, please share them in the comments. Because from now till March, I'll be in retreat mode, so it might be a few months before I can create another video to address this question. From the Himalayas, one of these spiritual lineages gradually extended eastward. While it wasn't referred to as Daoism until many centuries later, for simplicity's sake, we'll call it Daoism for now. For generations, the master carefully selected their disciples, often just a few individuals. In the Daoist view, it is better to lose the lineage for some time than risk selecting the wrong disciple. At higher levels, practitioners gained supernatural abilities, and a disciple with ill intentions could harm the world and impact the whole lineage. Master often identified potential disciples when they were children, sometimes even infants. Nevertheless, they continued to observe and test them secretly to ensure they were worthy of initiation. In ancient times, Daoism was highly secretive. Unlike a public religion that aimed to attract as many followers as possible. Even though masters selected the best candidates, not everyone progressed to the higher level due to various factors. Some remained stuck and couldn't advance. In Daoist thinking, it was because they lacked the merit to progress further. To accumulate more merit, they engaged in Wei Gong. The direct translation of Wei Gong is outer work, which could involve protecting an area from evil spirits, including exorcism, or protecting it from dangerous animals and bandits. But the most common Wei Gong was healing, since it usually generates less karma than other forms of Wei Gong. Some Daoists also served as government officials, aiming to positively impact society, but also access valuable resources like ancient scriptures and rare herbs and minerals for making elixirs. There were even a few famous cases where Daoists helped topple warlords and emperors, That's how they start to interact with the public. And it is also how traditional Chinese medicine got its start. In case you didn't know, the father of TCM is Daoist medicine. And many famous TCM doctors, like Xuan Zhen, the medicine king, were also Daoists. Furthermore, some disciples either gave up their path or kicked out by their masters for various reasons. Generally, they were not allowed to teach the Daoist practice to others. However, they could share the basics, such as philosophy, feng shui, qigong, martial arts, healing, herbal medicines, and so on. Still, it wasn't anything like a religion. It was more like a localized practices on a small scale, and this went on for centuries. Then came Lao Zi, whose birth name was Li Er. Lao Zi means old guy in Chinese. There were two different versions of how he got this name. One, he had the appearance of an old man even as a child. Two, he has the wisdom of an old wise man even as a child. Anyhow, he was highly intelligent and served as a librarian at the central library of the Eastern Zhou Dynasty. Accessible only to the emperor and high-ranking officials. After many years of service, with the Eastern Zhou Dynasty on the brink of dissolution into numerous warring states, Lao Zi decided it was time to leave. He told the others that he would travel westward to retire at Zhonglansan, a mountain that didn't exist at that time. To clarify, Zhong means end, Lan means south, and San means mountain. He was journeying to the southern end of the mountain range, which coincides with the Himalayas, the root of Taoism. It is now part of the Yunnan and Sichuan provinces, which happen to be my favorite parts of China. And I've seriously considered setting up a retreat center there. However, where Lao Zi ended up remains a mystery. Today there is a mountain called Zhonglansan, south of Xi'an, leading some to believe it was his destination. This mountain is home to many hermits who have established their huts there. And there's even an English documentary called Hermits about it. The official version of the story goes like this. There was a gate guard named Yuan Si who saw a radiant purple chi approaching from the east, indicating the arrival of an important spiritual figure. And sure enough, he crossed paths with Lao Zi. As an immigration officer, Yuan Si had the authority to stop Lao Zi from leaving. But he either begged or flexed his immigration muscles, asking Lao Zi to leave something behind before he would let him exit the gate. Yuan Si was no ordinary gate guard. He could see the purple chi, signifying his own spiritual attainment. Lao Zi stayed for several days and composed the famous Dao De Jing during this time. This text is the first to use the term Dao. A more detailed version of the story involved Lao Zi having a young boy who helped him carrying bamboo craft books. These books were heavy, and all scholars had a su tong or book boy to assist with such tasks. Lao Zi initially asked the boy if he understood the Dao De Jing, and the boy nodded. Lao Zi then removed some part and asked again, repeating the process until the boy couldn't comprehend anymore. Lao Zi then presented this shortened version to Yuan Si, the gate guard. Yuan Si was grateful and allowed Lao Zi to pass through the gate, subsequently presenting the Dao De Jing to the emperor. I don't know whether Yuan Xi did it purposely or it was really an accident. The book fell from the carnage, and the string tying it together loosened. Yuan Xi then resembled it like a puzzle. Hence, when reading the Dao De Jing today, you may notice that each chapter isn't always directly linked to the previous one, creating somewhat fragment feel. However, even when read independently, each chapter contained valuable wisdom. While Dao De Jing is widely known as a philosophical work, the Dao De Jing is also a guide for Daoist practice. But like most Daoist texts, if you are not part of the lineage, you won't fully grasp the practice aspects. You need a key from the Daoist lineage to unlock the hidden messages about the actual practice, or if you have reached a high spiritual level through another tradition. Unfortunately, the subtleties are often lost in translation due to the fundamental differences between Asian and Western languages. Asian languages are highly ambiguous, with one word carrying multiple meanings, enabling a single sentence to open up a whole matrix of interpretations. Western languages, on the other hand, are usually more precise. For example, one of the common phrases used in Chinese is, which literally means, have you eaten rice? But you can ask this at any time of the day. It could mean, have you eaten yet? Or how's your meal? Did you eat enough and enjoy it? It could also be a way of asking, how's your day? Is everything fine? It's like a bundled greeting. But if you say this to a Westerner who just learned Chinese but never lived in a Chinese-speaking community, they might reply, no, I don't plan to eat rice today. I'm not sure about Indian languages, but I suspect they work similarly. I remember when I first taught in India many years ago. During lunch breaks, the server asked if it was okay to serve me dessert. They are too sweet for me, so I shook my head to decline. But the server still put a few in my dish. I was a little puzzled, so I asked my student, if when you shake your head like this in India, does it mean yes or no? He told me it could mean either. So, alright, enough of the language stuff. After the Dao De Jing start gaining attention, other authors, possibly also in the Daoist lineage, like Zhang Zi, began to reference the term Dao in their works. Zhang Zi, in particular, provided further detailed explanations of the Dao. Speaking of Dao De Jing, did you know that there exist many different versions? 50 years ago, most versions had only minor differences. However, in the 1970s, a significant archaeological discovery was made at the Ma Wangdui tomb site. This site contained the tombs of three individuals from the Western Han Dynasty: Chancellor Li Chang, his wife Xin Jui, and a male believed to be their son. Li Chang seemed to be a Daoist, and the tomb was filled with advanced technology. Xin Jui's body was preserved so well that they could perform an autopsy and determined she died of heart attack. They even had translucent silk pajamas that were so lightweight that we still can't replicate them with today's technology. Furthermore, the first ever Dao Yin, which means moving Qigong book with diagrams, was discovered at this site. The Dao De Jing and the I Ching find here predate all known written versions by hundreds of years. The order of the Ma Wang Dui Dao De Jing chapters differed from the common version, and some sentences had opposite meanings. In 1993, the oldest known written version of the Dao De Jing was unearthed in a tomb believed to belong to a prince of the Chuan warrior state near the town of Guodan, dating back to 400 to 300 BC, just about a century after Lao Zi's journey to Zhonglansan, making it likely the closest thing to the original. But once again, it had a few sentences with opposite meanings. And the most shocking part is that it only about half the length of today's version. One group of scholars think it is a shortened version or incomplete one, while another group believe that scholars throughout the centuries kept adding and editing the original based on their understanding. That's not an uncommon practice. It is important to note that the original bamboo craft version didn't have any punctuation marks. Those punctuations we see in Dao De Jing today were added later. As you might know, moving or adding a punctuation, even one word earlier or later, can completely change the meaning of a sentence, which holds true for most languages. Anyway, the Dao De Jing is significant because it was the first book to mention the term Dao. During this time, many emperors sought out Daoists in hopes of obtaining the elixir, Wei Dan, or outer medicine that could grant them immortality. While some recruits may have been con artists, others developed substances akin to stimulants or ayahuasca, but often with poisonous or even deadly side effects. However, these experiments led to the accumulation of valuable chemistry knowledge. That's how gunpowder were invented. Meanwhile, authentic lineages continue their secretive practices behind the public gates. In the foundational Daoist practices, everyone usually worked on similar stuff. Daoyin, guiding qi around the body, along predetermined paths, and accumulating qi at specific energy centers. Different sects might have slightly variations, like a different Daoan path, or choosing to accumulate qi at the lower dantian first, while others may start with the Bai Wei. However, in advanced practices, differences amongst disciples can be much more significant, even within the same set. Each disciple's teaching from their masters are tailored to their unique characteristics, such as their dominant energy, interest, and talent. For example, if someone's dominant energy is fire, but all their practices focus on water-related energy, they can still progress through those practices, but the progress might be slower. In the five element theory, water extinguishes fire. So it's like putting twice the effort, but only getting half the result. Personalization is a crucial aspect in traditional medicine. Both TCM and Ayurveda view each individual differently, and tailor treatment to different body types, taking into account the season and the patient's environment. This personalized approach makes TCM and Ayurveda more effective in managing chronic and degenerative diseases compared to Western medicine, which often employs a one-size-fits-all approach. Moreover, because Taoist masters need to monitor their disciples' progress and adjust their practices accordingly, each master could only handle a few disciples. This is true for other lineages too. For example, Jesus only had 12 disciples. Even Buddha, who had hundreds of thousands of followers, had just 10 disciples who worked closely with him. And he passed the secret path on to just one of those 10, Mahakasyapa. Since each disciple learned something slightly or entirely different, and usually couldn't share their practices with others, when a few disciples passed on the teachings to their own students, of course with the master's permissions, each taught something different. This led to the gradual development of different schools or sects. Out of all these Taoist sects, most can trace their roots back to the five Taoist secret gates. Gates here refer to a sect, much like the well-known Dragon Gate. So who are these five secret gates? They are Tai Ji Gate, Dan Ding Gate, Fu Lu Gate, Jian Xian Gate, and Xuan Zhen Gate. You may wonder, I have been practicing Tai Chi Chuan, so I must be part of the Tai Chi Gate, right? It doesn't seem that it is so secret after all. Well, the Tai Chi Gate is in fact one of the more discreet sects among the five. While modern Tai Chi Chuan traces its roots back to the Tai Chi Gate, most people nowadays see it primarily as a gentle exercise, often missing its martial aspect. Even those who are aware of its martial applications, which many schools openly teach, might not fully grasp those fine details of breathing and especially internal qi flow in each movement. Let's say you are exceptionally talented and fortunate enough to have a master from this gate teaching you all these internal aspects. Even then, the Tai Chi form itself represents just the tip of the iceberg in terms of what the Tai Chi gate has to offer. It is more like the beginner's entrance level practice. Shen Zhen Gate, with Shen means mysterious, Zhen means real or authentic, lives up to its secretive name. I mentioned the Chinese novel Zhu Shen in my newsletter 3 years ago. I really don't know how it got J Dynasty as its English title, because the meaning of Zhu Shen is killing or punishing the immortals. This novel is very popular in China, even evolving into a movie, TV drama, animation, and RPG game. Its story is centered around the Xuan Zhen Gate, of course under a different name in the novel. My master believes that the author is either connected to this gate in his present life or tapped into his past life memories, as he wouldn't have known the details of this gate otherwise. Unfortunately, the novel has never been translated into English, and both the movie and TV series adaptations have altered the story to make it more appealing to the general audience, focusing on the romantic elements and omitting the cultivation practices. Jian Xian Gate, which translates to short immortal, is renowned for using the minds to control the energetic swords, enabling them to strike target many miles away. The development of this extraordinary ability, which is your way, the opposite of wei, the main teaching from the Dao De Jing, often becomes a significant challenge for sword immortals during the final stage of the Dao path, which is return to the void and merge with the Dao. This emphasizes wei. Relying on supernatural abilities, including energy healing, can hinder one's spiritual progress. This is true even in other spiritual lineages. 10 years ago, I stopped offering energy healing, and this is one of the reasons. Sword immortals are categorized into 9 grades. The lower 3 grades focus on forming the Qi sword, the middle 3 on using the Qi sword, and the higher 3 on becoming true sword immortals. The sword immortal was first mentioned in the book Lianzi. The emergence of the sword immortal traditions can be attributed to the historical factors during the Warring States period. During this time, young people showed great enthusiasm for swordsmanship and combat, leading to the development of various sword techniques. However, after the unification of China by Qin Dynasty, swordsmanship lost its prominence. For almost 2,000 years, it seems the tradition virtually disappeared from the public awareness. It wasn't until the middle of the Qing Dynasty that the sword immortal tradition resurfaced and reached its peak, with 4 major sects: Kunlun, Huashan, Emei, and Taishan. Yet they've become low profile again, and are now scattered mainly in the Sichuan region. Due to the distinct nature of their practice, the sword immortal tradition could not be widely taught. Even during its peak, it remained a relatively small and isolated community, becoming the most secretive gate among the 5. Those who chose to re-enter society often concealed themselves within other sects. For instance, Zhang Sanfeng, often associated with Wu Dang and Tai Ji Chuan, was also a sword immortal. He emphasized the inner cultivation of the elixir and the outworked display of the golden sword as the essence of sword immortal cultivation. Lü Dongbin relied for inner alchemy. The practice of Dan Ding Gate always had a sword on his back in nearly all his portraits. He once claimed to have learned sword immortal techniques from the fire dragon sword immortal, whose sword techniques were divided into the Law sword and the Dao sword. Lü Dongbin himself later developed the Wisdom 3 swords. His swords are referenced in various classical texts, which are collected in the Dao Zhang, the Daoist canon, which is a huge collection of all authentic Daoist texts from Dao De Jing till recent time. Unfortunately, most of those texts have never been translated to English. I had tried to translate a chapter of Lü Dongbin's sword immortal text by Google Translate and ChatGPT, but they were not quite right. The ChatGPT translation is slightly better. Anyway, I leave the original Chinese text in the comments section. If you have time, you can try to translate that word by word to see what you can discover. The well-known poet Li Bai from the Tang Dynasty was a swordsman who aspired to use his sword to bring order to the chaotic world at a young age. During his travels in the Sichuan area, he encountered a sword immortal and became a disciple of the sword immortal lineage. Later in life, he didn't find success in official positions, but gained fame as a poet and drinker. His poems are still being taught and studied from primary school to universities nowadays. Many of his poems indeed conveyed the inner vision and cultivation state that are unique from the Jian Xian Gate. I also recall another story about this gate. My master told me that he met one of the top members of the Jian Xian Gate in Taiwan during a spiritual retreat. This Jian Xian master shared that upon learning that a spiritual guru would come to Taiwan to spread the teaching, he sent his sword as a test. This action may reflect his duty to oversee the spiritual aspect of the area. Surprisingly, his sword was confiscated and did not return, indicating the guru's exceptionally high level. He was later initiated into that spiritual lineage. These three gates, Tai Ji, Xuan Zhen, and Jian Xian, have remained secretive, passing on their lineage to only a select few. The Dan Ding and Fu Lu gates are different. Some of their branches have effectively evolved into what we now recognize as the Daoist religion. Let's start with the Fu Lu gate. Fu Lu means talisman and seal. And a typical Daoist talisman looks like this. Using the cinnabar, which is mercury sulfide, to draw on a piece of yellow paper. These talismans serve various purposes, typically used for protection, healing, and also fighting, containing, or eliminating those non-physical beings, but sometimes physical beings as well. The Fu Lu Gate remained quite secretive until the Eastern Han Dynasty, when Zhang Ling found the Tianshi Dao. Tianshi means celestial master, referring to a spiritual leader who has the ability to communicate with the heavens and divine powers, guide followers in religious practice, and perform various rituals. Zhang Ling was the 8th generation grandchild of the first prime minister of the Han Dynasty. His deep knowledge of Dao De Jing was apparent from a young age, and he began working in the imperial court as a bo si, a role focused on education and the preservation of important documents and records, somewhat similar to the work of Lao Zi during his time in the imperial court. Despite his popularity amongst ordinary citizens, Zhang Ling left his position due to government corruption, which hindered his ability to contribute more to society. During a personal retreat at Longfu San, the Dragon and Tiger Mountain, later becoming one of the four most important Daoist mountains, Zhang Ling dreamed of Lao Zi. Lao Zi advised him that if he truly wanted to benefit society, he should openly spread the teachings. Lao Zi then transmitted to him Jing Yi Dao, which became the foundation of his religion. Consequently, Zhang revered Lao Zi as the spiritual founder of his lineage or religion. Zhang Ling wasn't the first to create a religion based on the Daoist lineage and practices, but his Daoist religion was the first that has endured till now. while many others have disappeared. Three primary factors contribute to his success. Firstly, for all large-scale endeavors, funding is crucial. To join his lineage, each student needs to contribute 5 buckets of rice, earning this religion the moniker, the 5 bucket rice set. The second factor involves Zhang and his religion's commitment to tangible good deeds that met the immediate needs of the general public. Rather than preaching too many abstract concepts like the Tao. In the past, actually, even nowadays, when people are in bad luck, many things go wrong, they will likely blame that on some bad spirit following them. And this set is renowned for using talismans to cleanse those bad spirits. In times of natural disaster, they generously distribute rice, provide shelter, and more. Furthermore, when education wasn't free, being part of this religion provides not only literacy, but also education in various fields, including science, music, art, astrology, and philosophy, making it a school that offered almost free education. They also provide healing. My master recalled back in the 50s, when Hong Kong was still relatively poor, they provide medical service for free, teaching those who are too poor to afford herbal medicine to use daily staples like soy sauce, vinegar, ginger, garlic, and even fingernails and hair to make the medicine they need. Surprisingly, those cheap medicines also worked quite well. Even nowadays, they just symbolically charge $10, like US dollar, which includes the prescribed herbal medicines already. While the average price of TCM doctor's consultation plus herbal medicine in Hong Kong is about $70. The third factor behind the success of the Daoist religion created by Zhang Ling was his own background as a well-known former high-ranking government official. His connections allowed him to garner support and avoid government suppression. Unlike many similar religions that disappeared due to government actions. This is essentially how Daoist religion began and how Lao Zi became its founder. Now, let me share a bit of my experience with Daoist talisman. About 20 years ago, my mother had a friend she referred as Sister Lin, who came from New York with her friend. During a gathering, Lin's friend met Mr. Ding, who, without a formal introduction, like saying, "I'm Hu and Hu, nice to meet you," she directly said, "Oh, you have a Daoist talisman in your body." In response, Mr. Ding mentioned he carried a protective talisman given by his feng shui master beneath his clothing. I believe that both of them have some connection to the Fulu Gate. My master is a short enthusiast. At one point of time, he had a collection of over 100 swords. One day, he led me to his sword rack and asked me to sense which one is unique. After I point to one of them, he told me this sword is sealed with a talisman. So those who are sensitive can feel the power of a talisman. Mr. Ding, the one who carried a protective talisman, later became my feng shui master and shared one of his experiences with the Daoist talisman. While learning feng shui in Singapore, one day he was walking with his master when a young boy fell in front of them, breathing profusely. Mr. Ding's master used his short fingers to draw a talisman in the air, and remarkably, the breathing quickly stopped. This demonstrates that a Daoist talisman doesn't need to be a mere piece of yellow paper, just like the talisman on my master's sword, which is invisible. Another story dates back to around 20 years ago, when I was learning Qigong from a Daoist master. During a meditation session, the room next door began playing loud music with a really fast beat, like boom, 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 boom. You know, music, especially that beat, can affect our heart rhythm. So it was really difficult for us to calm down and meditate. Well, we were supposed to have our eyes closed during meditation, but I peeked and saw the master walk to the wall next to the room with loud music and use his fingers to draw something in the air. I presumed he drew a talisman. Within a minute, the music stopped until we were about to finish our meditation. You may say it is coincidental, but once you are on a spiritual path or aligned with the Tao, you encounter a lot of such coincidences. In the Shibasu set 2 and the Tai Chi Legong, some movements involve short fingers. I hope by now you see the importance of short fingers in the Taoist practices. Not only you can use them to draw the talisman, but also for healing. Indeed, it is also related to the beginner grade short immortal practice. But for some reasons, many students tend to make the short fingers like this, like the scissors, and the fingers not straight. Maybe that's their favorite pose for taking photos. So please make the proper soft finger in your Qigong and Neigong practice. It's not that hard. Having said that, my current master, he doesn't even need to use his soft fingers to draw those non-physical talismans. He just gazed and done. This highlights that while the symbols and words on the talisman hold importance, the key lies in the spiritual power of the person drawing it. Otherwise, anyone can simply photocopy them without the need to learn and practice. While this gate is the most open to the public among the five, those advanced level practices remained exclusive to a select few. Finally, let's talk about Dan Deng Gate. Dan in Dan Deng, akin to the Dan in Dan Tian, meaning medicine. Deng is a tool used in cooking important meals, and the Daoists employ it to make tangible medicines or elixir, Wei Dan. Wei Dan signifies outer medicine, while Lei Dan refers to inner medicine, where practitioners use their bodies as the Deng to cook the energetic Dan. Some also describe it as inner alchemy. One of the most famous figures from this gate is Lü Dongbin. Many in the Western world are familiar with him through the book The Secret of the Golden Flower. However, during Lü Dongbin's era, the tradition was to pass the lineage to a select few. It wasn't until a few hundred years later, when a high-ranking military officer named Wang Chongyang, who was also a Daoist of the Dan Deng Gate, in 1159 AD created a new religion known as Xuan Zhen sect. Xuan Zhen means complete reality, and is a religion rooted in Daoism, while incorporating teaching from Buddhism and Confucianism. Wang Chongyang had only 7 disciples, with the most famous Chao Chu Ji, significantly contributing to the sect's growth. I previously introduced a movie called An End to Killing in one of my newsletters. Based on the true story of Chao Chu Ji, the film talks about how at the age of 74, he traveled thousands of miles to Middle Asia to meet Genghis Khan, persuading him to cease unnecessary killing, and teaching him about Tao and longevity. Genghis Khan held him in high regard, referring to him as a true immortal. With Genghis Khan's blessing, the Xuan Zhen religion rapidly spread during that time. Like many religions and Taoist sects, Xuan Zhen also later branched into various sects, the most famous being Cao Chu Ji's Dragon Gate. Some also believe that Cao Chu Ji was the original author of the most famous and popular Chinese novel, Journey to the West. He too embarked on a long journey to the West himself to meet Genghis Khan. The novel is based on the true story of the legendary pilgrimage of the Tang Dynasty Buddhist monk Xuan Zhang. Xuan Zhang traveled to the western regions, which encompass Central Asia and India, in his quest to study and obtain Buddhist sutras. He endured many trials and much suffering during his journey. One of the most famous sutras that Xuan Zhang translated into Chinese was the Heart Sutra, which remains the most popular and studied sutra to this date. There is a movie called Xuan Zhang that you should be able to watch on YouTube for free. While the popular version of the novel Journey to the West is more exaggerated and dramatic than Cao's original version, it still contains many teachings from both the Buddhist and Taoist traditions, including some hidden Taoist practices. Since the formation of the Xuan Zhen religion, numerous texts about Dan Dao and inner alchemy have been created. However, most of these texts are written in a way that, without the key from the master of the Dan De Gate, one will not fully grasp their true meaning. This is also true for many Buddhist sutras, where most people only understand their surface meaning. To unlock the inner and ultimate meanings, which teaches you how to practice and how to assess whether you are on the right path, you need the key from the master. These three layers of meanings, surface, inner, and ultimate, are often contained within the same sutra. In conclusion, this has been a brief introduction to the five secret Daoist gates and how two of them, particularly the Fulu Gate, have evolved into the Daoist religion. It is common for sects to borrow practices from other gates, as seen with figures like Lü Dongbin and Zhang Sanfeng, who were also Jian Xian sought immortals. Therefore, it should not be surprising to find Daoist from the Fulu Gate Temple at Longfusan, the Dragon Tiger Mountain, practicing inner alchemy. Just like our lineage, which primarily belongs to the Dan De Gate, but has also incorporated practices from the Tai Chi Gate. While there are many sects and gates, as long as their ultimate aims align with returning to the void and uniting with the Tao, and they offer clear paths, practices, and methods to achieve that, they should be authentic Taoist lineages. Just like in hiking, there are different paths and trails leading to the same destination, some shorter, some more challenging, but more fun. Choose the path that suits you best. So this is how Taoism evolved from a spiritual practice for a select few to Lao Zi, who named the lineage as Tao, and from the five secret Taoist gates to the Taoist religion as we know it now. If you enjoyed this video, be sure to subscribe to this channel and sign up for the free newsletter on my website. While most of my newsletters are in written format, I occasionally create videos like this one in video format.